立法會主席。
The President。
請繼續站立。
Members will please remain standing while the Chief Executive enters the chamber. The Chief Executive.
議員返回座位。
Members, please return to your seat.
行政長官向
The Chief Executive will first address the Council.President, members, fellow citizens, Chief Executive, please hold a minute. Now, I'd like to remind members again, if members breach the order of the proceedings, I will ask the members to leave the chamber at once. Chief Executive, President, members, fellow citizens, yesterday I delivered my second policy address. The theme is support the needy.Let youth flourish and unleash Hong Kong's potential. To achieve this objective, I have announced a series of new policy initiatives in the policy address in relation to the economy, the poor, the old and the infirm, the next generation, land, housing and transportation, environmental protection, conservation, healthcare, leisure and culture and municipal services,A constitutional system and governance and so on. This is to show the determination of this government to address a number of long-standing issues at its core. Now, in economy, we will continue to strengthen our cooperation with the mainland and other countries on all fronts. We will further develop our financial services, trade, tourism, professional services, logistics, high-value-added shipping services, dispute resolution services, creative industry, intellectual property, innovation and technology. And because there's rapid development in the Peripheral Delta, and then the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge and Tuen Mun to Chek Lap Kok Link will soon be completed. Next few years, we will focus our development on the Lantau Island. There will be a man-made island for the development of bridgehead economy, and we will be building the Northeast Lantau Metropolis. On a poverty issue, we are determined to resolve that. We will provide support to the old, the infirm, and the poor.We will launch the low income working family allowance. We're spending of $3 billion a year. Over 200,000 low income families and 710,000 people will benefit from it. We'll regularize a number of community care fund projects. We'll improve the CSSA system with a focus on supporting.School children receiving CSSA, and for CSSA adults, we will have incentives for them to work. We'll also be launching a series of measures to increase the number of subsidized elderly care home places by 5,000. And then we will, through the special scheme on privately owned sites for welfare users, to provide additional places. And then we'll extend the $2 transport fare concession to children with abilities aged below 12. And starting from the first quarter of next year, we will incorporate green minibuses into the scheme by phases. And in 2014 to 15, there will be Chinese language curriculum, second language learning framework for ethnic minority students in secondary and primary schools. Another focus of this policy address is on education, employment, and all-round development to nurture our next generation. So for young people with different abilities, aspirations, and education level, we have a diversity of learning, training, and development opportunities. And for the pre-primary education, voucher value will be increased by $2,500 per year for two consecutive school years. There will be also a series of measures to increase the number of opportunities for students to receive tertiary education in Hong Kong and outside Hong Kong. And for university graduates, the arrangement for loan repayment to start after 1 year of graduation will be regularized. 33,000 students will benefit from that. In the policy address, I've also put forward various ways to help young people make life planning and strengthen their vocational education so that we will see young people unleashing the potential and there will be masters in all trades. I know, of course, that people are very concerned about housing issue. In the last policy address, I've launched a series of short, medium to long-term measures to increase housing land supply. In the past year, the work of the government has been making good progress. We've already identified enough sites for the committed 170,000 public housing units and 17,000 HOS units. We would have also decided to adopt the recommendation of the long-term housing strategy steering committee to increase housing supply. In the next 10 years, the new target would be 470,000 units for the total production. 60% of that would be public housing. Many have expected more HOS, and the new batch will be on pre-sale this year. And in the policy address, I've also come up with concrete measures. Apart from the northern Hong Kong Island and peninsula where there's dense population, for other density zones, we would appropriately raise the plot ratio by about 20%. We'll also lift the moratorium for Wafu Estate in the southern part of Port Phlom. And we'll redevelop Wafu Chin, and that will provide Wafu Estate, and we'll provide an additional 11,900 public housing and HOS units. The government is also committed to advancing the constitutional development in strict compliance with the basic law and the interpretations and decisions of the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress. And after extensive public consultation, we'll collate the views and proceed with the five-step process. The government and myself are totally committed to achieving this objective. I understand the Central People's Government is equally sincere in seeing universal suffrage in Hong Kong as scheduled. I ask members to support the various policy measures in the policy address, and you will work together with the government with one heart to address the various deep-seated issues in Hong Kong. I would like to mention that the government would like to again initiate the proposal of Innovation and Technology Bureau. This is a measure long asked for by the sector. That's also why public support, including many members in this chamber. I hope that this time round, we could the LegCo would pass this proposal. I look forward to listening to your views on the policy address. Thank you.
The Chief Executive will now answer the questions from members. Mr. Tan Kabiu. Mr. Chief Executive, yesterday you published the policy address. Grassroots families and the disadvantaged groups have given you their applause, but we, the FTU, cannot. On the one hand, we have the grassroots. On the other hand, we have the labor sector. We cannot clap our hands to give you the applause. As far as labor policies are concerned, you haven't given us anything. Therefore, we have to adopt a very cautious view concerning your policy address. You talked about vocational training and vocational education, but still only trying to address the problem of manpower shortage and youth development. But what about the hardship of the employed? We have got 3 million workers. What we are looking forward to, we want to have a reasonable wage. We don't want to get subsidies. Please do not make a lengthy statement. We want to have retirement protection. We want to be able to have savings. We don't want to be on CSSA when we are old. So in your policy address, you have talked about or in your manifesto, you have talked about lowering the percentage of the MPF being used to offset the long service payment. You haven't talked about that. Does it mean that you're not going to do anything about it? The Chief Executive. Mr. President, when I ran for the post of the CD, I had a manifesto, and it was in the form of a draft. I went around to seek views from the public, and then I finalized my manifesto. When I launched it, I said that it wasn't just meant for initiating. It is also meant for my governance. In my 5-year term, I will gradually implement the pledges in the manifesto given to various sectors of the community. As far as the offsetting of the LSP, I did talk about it in my manifesto. In this year's policy address, I haven't addressed this point. It doesn't mean that I'm not going to tackle this problem during my term. Now, the offsetting of the LSP by making use of the MPF, it is a long-term issue. We need to deal with it gradually. I will honor my manifesto pledge. I hope during my term, I will listen more to the views of the labor sector as well as the business sector, including the SMEs' concerns about the rise in business costs. As a result of this, they are concerned about it. We want to look at the cost implications. We want to look at the impact on the labor sector. We want to strike a balance. We will consider the matter carefully. Mr. Tankerville, in your policy address this year, in your policy address last year, you are totally silent on this matter. How come that we can be confident that you would have time to deal with it? It involves the amendment of two pieces of legislation. Even if we assume that you're going to honor your pledge, should we go after Mr. Zheng, the FS, Mr. Chen, Professor Chen, Mrs. Carrie Lam, or you yourself in relation to this matter? Who should we hold accountable? We have talked to the labor sector, we've talked to the business sector. In relation to this matter, in the run-up to the policy address, we have had some initial dialogues. We hope that we'll have more in-depth dialogues in this regard in the future. Concerning the offsetting proposal, initially speaking, we have listened to the views from different sectors. They've got different ideas, whether there should be an offsetting and how, and as was the ratio. There are different views on different aspects, so we'd like to collect your views comprehensively, and then we can do a proper job. Mr. Raymond Wong, thank you, Mr. President. Yesterday, I had an eye problem, and the lights are really strong, so I was absent from the chamber. Never have I seen this before. There was this person delivering the policy address. He was mechanical. He was not... he was not emotional at all. For the political reform, there were only 126 words on this topic. Last week, Mr. Tam Chi-jin, the secretary, gave an answer to the public hearing session here. He said that in relation to organization nomination, we haven't found this term in the basic law. We're supposed to have it in the basic law. Now, Mr. 6H9, now, organizational nomination, where can we find it in the basic law? Qiao Xiaoyang, Li Fei, they are the lackeys from the Communist Party. You regard them as sycophants and you have included them in the political reform. I think the three main group responsible for constitutional reform should go to hell. So where can we find the term organizational nomination in the basic law? It is a fake consultation. How come that you still say that you're consulting us? Sit down after you've asked your question. In the basic law, this is what is said. A nomination committee, which is having a comprehensive composition, and that's the process of election. In fact, we have been very hardworking, putting in our efforts and listening to the views of the public. Well, broadly representative in relation to the nominating committee and in relation to a democratic process. Now you talk about an organizational nomination. What sort of an organizational nomination are you talking about? Please explain the matter to us. Well, Mr. Wong, you must leave the chamber. Mr. Wong, you must leave the chamber immediately. You must leave the chamber immediately. Just now, your conduct was mostly disorderly. Mr. Wong, you must leave immediately. Mr. Wong Yuk-man, you must leave the chamber immediately. I'm not insulting him. He has to go to hell. Mr. Wong, you must leave the chamber immediately. It is vacant and empty. You must leave the chamber immediately.
Ibrahim Yu.
Mr. Yu Kok Him. Thank you, Mr. President. Chief Executive, for this year's policy address, you have been responsive to public views. And as far as the policies are concerned, you have been proactive. To this, we have showed our support to you. This morning, Mr. Leung, you attended a phone-in radio program jointly hosted by a number of radio stations. Residents in Hong Kong have held a positive attitude towards the policy address, and you have shown concern towards the poor as well as the young, and they have a positive response. At the same time, we have learned that for this policy address, as far as the recurrent expenditure is concerned, there will be a drastic increase to the tune of $20 billion. They are really concerned. They are afraid that after increasing the recurrent expenditure drastically, we may not be able to afford it, and as a result, we may have to increase the taxes. Now, in your policy address, in Chapter 5, you have talked about housing, land, and transport. And in that chapter, you have proposed a lot of plans and projects for the short, medium, and long terms. So we are going to see a lot of mega infrastructural projects. Last week, in a single day's time, we received two proposals to increase the funding for public works projects to the tune of $15 billion. It is really alarming. You said that machinery, labor costs, and tight labor supply, etc., have accounted for the drastic increase in the amount of overrun of the budget. So, Mr. Leung, are you aware of the seriousness of the problem? Are you going to talk to the various officials in different departments and bureaus so that there will be coordination, so that you are aware of the progress of various projects, so that the costs will not escalate astronomically?
Chief Executive, on spending and expenditure, the SAR government will continue to comply strictly with the basic law provisions. That is, our fiscal philosophy is that it's not just starting this year, that we're still going by the basic law requirements. That is, we keep expenditure within income and we do not spend beyond our means. Now, as I said yesterday, I've explained our philosophy on spending. I said that money should be spent on the needy. It should be used to spend on improving the quality of life of Hong Kong, boosting our competitiveness. We should spend it on the next generation and spend it on investment in the next generation. Now, we should support the poor, the old, and the infirm. And we believe we could afford to spend on them. In the past decade or so, because of our collective effort and because of the development in Asia and also because of support of our country, we've been doing relatively well in terms of fiscal position. And I believe as we go on, we could continue to achieve that. But of course, we have to think for the rainy days. After 2018, our labor force will shrink. So that's a possibility that it may have an impact on government's finances. And that's something we have to face in future. But at the same time, we know if we work very hard to expand our economy on in various sectors, then we will be able to maintain relatively high rate of economic development, I think that's the positive way about it. So I think we should spend money on the needy, and then have confidence that we could still go by the requirement of basic law, as we've done in the past decade or so. On project costs escalate, and some public projects have seen the original estimates being exceeded. Yes, my colleagues in the government are aware of that. They're really concerned. We will try various ways to control cost. For example, for public works projects standards, is there any way we could make savings without affecting the functions of the projects? And then what about advanced studies for work? So how can we do better there? Now, we're going to have another round of major infrastructural projects coming on the pipeline. We will keep to this approach in making sure public money is properly spent. Mr. Prohim, yes, you have to be very careful with the spending of public money. But then project costs soar. That's because we are embarking on so many projects at the same time. Most of these projects are government projects. That's why there is this scenario. So that's why in a market, of course, there's no choice but for prices to soar. So Chief Executive, have you considered this? In terms of planning the programs of projects, maybe there should be priorities. Some could be delayed a bit. So could you consider that? Chief Executive, I fully share Mr. Kwok Him's observation. Well, for various reasons, major projects are launched at the same time. Of course, they will have an impact on project costs. And even for the private sector, the project costs may be affected too. Just a few months ago, I heard from a quantity surveyor. He said that this is the case because there are now quite a number of engineering projects. So even if they send out tender invitations to five companies, only three came back with a bid because the other companies have already had their hands full. They couldn't take on extra projects. So if that's the case, of course, project costs will go up, and it wouldn't just affect the public sector, the government, but also the private sector. At the end of the day, of course, the cost will be passed on to the public. So that's why we have to take this very seriously. Now, in the course of planning of public projects, we try to launch the projects or space out the projects one by one. We don't want to bunch up the projects. But then there are factors beyond our control. For instance, during the course of planning, delays have been experienced. Now, instead of January, for instance, a project has to start in June and so on. So where is to do with the programming of projects? I hope you appreciate the difficulties on the part of the government as well. Please give us your support so that we could shorten the delay as far as possible. Ms. Sit Ho, thank you. The Chief Executive said yesterday there are two ways to spend money. One, if where we should do something, if there's no money, then we can't do it. But then another way is that if we see something that we need to do, we have to proceed, and but we have to find ways to develop the economy. Now, I think that's the right attitude, the second one, and you could apply it to constitutional reform. The public would like to have fair election. We want to hold the government accountable and prevent corruption. For public nomination or political parties nomination, the public believe these are nomination procedures that command credibility among the public. But the three-person task force or the Beijing officials keep saying that public nomination is illegal, is a departure from the legal framework, so there's no way we could take this consultation forward. So you are now asking the public to accommodate the interpretations of the basic law. So Chief Executive, will you direct the three-person task force, and would you also tell the CPG that the consultation should collate public views objectively instead of imposing constraints on how the public could express their views? At the end, we are asked to accept selection instead of universal suffrage. Chief Executive, as I said, I am completely sincere in advancing constitutional reform. And of course, one of the important aspects of the constitutional reform exercise is to seek public views. Now, since the public consultation started just about a month ago, I and the three officials, principal officials in charge of the task and the whole government, actually, have been listening to public views with humility. We try to listen as far as possible without stating our views. But then, by doing so, that's led to some criticisms in the community. They asked how come the government wouldn't come up with this proposal, how come it's only listening. I believe we have time, and during this period, I think we should listen. And for the LegCo members or anyone in the community, if you are concerned about this, you have an interest in this issue, I hope that there will be a pragmatic and rational way of expressing your views. On the public nomination and other suggestions, at this stage, we are more than happy to listen to your justifications. And I could give this pledge to Ms. Sit Ho. For all the views collected during this period, they will all be collated in our consultation report objectively, and we won't leave out anything. And I'm sure the Central People's Government also attaches great importance to public views on constitutional reform. President, for a nomination with selection, then that means there's an election on the face, but actually it's all about manipulation. Now, the basic law is to help us achieve universal suffrage, not to restrict public rights or civil rights. But if eventually you impose selection on the public, even if you may get your way, but the public won't be happy. Now, you've already missed out on opportunities in the past. Ms. Hill, do not dwell on the statement. I just want to tell the Chief Executive, as long as there's still a breath left in me, we would not allow any phony election for our next generation. Now, on One Country, Two Systems, Hong Kong People Ruling Hong Kong, High Degree of Autonomy, these have been implemented well. This is a fact recognized by the international community. Ms. Lim Leung Sing, take your seat at once. Stop shouting from your seat. Members, if you breach order again, I will ask you to leave the chamber at once. Mr. Leung Sing. Mr. Leung Sing. On the pause address, we see that the Chief Executive has put financial services first among the various industries because the financial services account for 16% of our GDP. That's one-sixth of our GDP. Well, this is a result of the hard work of the financial services personnel over many years. So this percentage just to record their hard work. Now, the financial services sector accounts for about one-sixth of our GDP. Among 70 members, there are two members here representing the financial services sector. We have a heavy burden on our shoulder. Financial services have been making huge contribution to Hong Kong. Mr. Ng, please come to your question. Well, since that's the case, since the financial services sector is so important and the center of financial services in the central district. Now, there's some who are advocating Occupy Central, and the financial sector has strong reaction to that because that's where we make our living. Now, but why don't they occupy Saiwan or Tai Hau or Sandy Bay even? Mr. M, please come to your question. Well, in Thailand recently, there's such an Occupy movement, and that's led to immense economic loss. If that's the case in Hong Kong, would you consider doing a stress test like what the Hong Kong MA asked banks to do? Now, let's say if there's occupation of 1 day, 1 month, 1 quarter, or even a year, how much economic loss would be generated, and what would be the biggest possible loss to the public? Can you tell the sector, please?
The Chief Executive, Mr. President, about the loss to be caused, I think you must have seen from the press that some economists have already come up with an assessment. For the administration, we haven't got anything else to add. What I should say is that any law-breaking activities will be acted upon by the law enforcement agencies, and we'll do it in a just way, and we want to maintain law and order in the society. Mr. Ng Sing, if I may follow up, well, recently there was a seminar, and in fact it was something held in great respect by the people in the financial services industry. Mr. Professor Lui Ding-ming has said that it would cost us over $1 billion a day. Now, recently in Thailand, their stock exchange was occupied, and so they have to be relocated, and it has caused a lot of economic losses to Thailand. So I want to know if the administration is going to study the matter further so as to give us and the citizens at large more confidence so that we can get ready for anything that may happen in the future. Mr. President, two things here. First of all, political reform. The SALG will, with modesty, listen to the views from different walks of life. We hope that the whole community will be like the SALG, and that is, will be rational and peaceful in dealing with political reform, talk about it, and also implement it. The SALG has the duty to maintain law and order in Hong Kong. In relation to the Hong Kong police force, as far as the maintenance of law and order, I have a lot of confidence in their ability. Ms. Claudia Mo.
Thank you, Mr. President. In Hong Kong, we always talk about the aging of the population. So we should encourage our young people to stay in Hong Kong to contribute to the success of Hong Kong. I think that's the slogan of the DAB. But then you are encouraging the young people to go northwest for university education. You even say that the government is going to provide a $15,000 subsidy to them a year. And then you have this Guangxi story. In fact, this person refinanced his property, and then he's borrowed, and then it was with that he was able to go to Guangxi. Now you're saying that the people of Hong Kong should make use of opportunities in the mainland and outside of China. Well, in fact, if you read the English version, you are talking about mainland and overseas opportunities. How come that you are asking that the people of Hong Kong, the young people of Hong Kong, to go to the mainland for work and for development? We haven't got any overseas taxes. So what are you doing here? Is it a matter of colonialism? I think all along we know that Ms. Claudia Mo has very strong views concerning national and local sort of issues. In Hong Kong, many young people have chosen to further their studies on the mainland. This is because they have seen opportunities for development on the mainland. Sorry, I have omitted one point. How come that Taiwan universities are not being included? Ms. Mo, please sit down. This is not a debate. The CE is responding to your questions. While he's giving an answer, please be patient. Wait for him to finish his answer, and then you may ask a short follow-up question. Thank you, Mr. President. In Hong Kong, many young people are going to the mainland for further studies, including many from the grassroots families. This is because on the mainland, the cost of living is lower, and the number of such students is increasing quite rapidly. Since I have assumed office, in relation to myself and my principal officials, I've got this clear requirement. That is, whenever we go to the mainland for a visit, we'll try to find time to visit. Whether we go to the northern part or southern part of China, we should find time to visit those who live on the mainland, work on the mainland, and have business on the mainland. We should understand more about the life on the mainland in relation to such Hong Kong residents. On two occasions when I went to Guangxi, I met many Hong Kong students studying in Guangxi. Quite a lot of them are pursuing a study in traditional Chinese medicine. They're interested to practice Chinese medicine either on the mainland or in Hong Kong. There is quite a large number of such students. Well, in Hong Kong, our young people have got different interests. They have got different aspirations. In order to enable them to unleash their potential, I think it is right for us to give them some subsidies if they want to study on the mainland. So I think it's one of the ways to nurture our next generation, and it will be effective. Ms. Claudia Mo, now Guangxi. I don't think it has got anything to do with Chinese medicine. I think it's a matter of population policy. How come that in your policy address, you have talked about the mainland, Pearl River Delta region, etc., but you don't have a word on the question of one-way permits being part of the population policy? I think the basic law has made it clear that we are entitled to having a word about the number of migrants. I think at least we should have the approval right. Is it because you don't want to offend Beijing and therefore you dare not raise such sensitive issues? The CS4A, as well as the Secretary for Security, have answered this question on many occasions. In accordance with the provisions of the Basic Law, we have been making the arrangements. And then for the one-way permit holders, they get approval to come to Hong Kong, mostly because of the reason of family reunion. And we've also got the mothers of Hong Kong permanent residents. If I give the approval right to Ms. Claudia Mo, I don't think Ms. Mo would deny the need of family reunion. Mr. Abraham Shack.
Mr. CE, in this council fight for the equal opportunity for minority race and the special education needs for children, I sincerely thank you for your genuine but modest contribution to their fight for equal opportunity. I'm sure that they will benefit from your very generous contributions towards the $200 million for their education. Secondly, I applaud you for taking a revolutionary stance against the archaic, colonial, and arbitrary system of the Land Department in assessing premium by introducing a pilot scheme of arbitration. That would surely help to bring about more supply of private housing to the people of Hong Kong. Thank you. I will support you in your this year Chief Executive Report. GJ,
Mr. President, I have been moved by the two stories told by the CE. One was about a young person wishing to have a larger home so that the young couple may have one more child. And then there was this kindergartner telling you that he would like you to tell him where he could find a home. I really hope that the people of Hong Kong can afford a property. But then our aspirations are a far cry from the reality. When we look at the facts, when we look at the reality, well, since the year 2010 and up to 2013, the number of transactions in property have dropped from 150,000 to 50,000 this year. How come that you think that we have got properties to purchase? You see such a sharp fall. And for the people of Hong Kong, you say that we are able to afford a home. But then we have got very special provisions. In the year 2010 and all the way up to 2013, the prices have gone up by 30%. And then we have got 50,000 transactions only. Yesterday, you already said that there were 9,000 units in the past 5 years. Please ask your question quickly, Mr. Shen. But then they can only buy first-hand properties, but not the second-hand properties. Mr. CE, according to what you say, People should be able to find homes to buy, but where are they? Can they really afford such high prices? Mr. Chair, please ask your question. If you have asked your question, please take your seat. The question is, we have got the high land price policy. Are you going to change it? Are you going to study how it should be changed?
Honourable Sheikh for his remarks. I and my government place a great deal of emphasis on helping ethnic minority groups who are very much part of the big Hong Kong family to integrate into the society. There are certain obstacles that they face on a day-to-day basis that can be dealt with through the initiatives on the part of government and also the work of many community organizations out there. I hope members of the ethnic minority groups will be forthcoming to work with government to allow, for example, their children to learn better Chinese. And we will take the joint efforts of the schools, the community organizations concerned, and also the government to actually achieve this goal. But it is our determination to move forward, to actually do it. While I'm speaking on this subject, perhaps I could just highlight the fact that I chose two children who are Hong Kong children. They are as much Hong Kong children as ethnic Chinese children of Hong Kong, two ethnic minority children in the photograph on the cover of my last year's policy address. That's...
Leung Kwok Hong,
Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, I've warned you already. I now order you to leave the chamber at once.
Leung Kwok Hong,
Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, leave at once. Leave at once.
Leung
Kwok Hong, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, stop fooling around. Leave the chamber at once.
You are devil! You should go to hell!
Mr. Leung, you are now holding up the questioning time. Leave at once. Chief Executive.
On the question of the use of modification as a mechanism to determine the level of modification premium, in the process of lease modification, which is the point that I think the Honourable Member referred to. Yes, it is a new initiative on the part of the government. It doesn't occupy a huge paragraph in the policy address, but I think it is important. And again, it is important for the development industry to be forthcoming, to actually initiate the modification application process, because the government can't initiate the process for developers. And if the two sides cannot come eye to eye on the question of the level of premium payable, then we use arbitrators to determine that figure.
就是因为刚才... Now, just now, Mr. Sheikh asked two questions in English. Now, as I switch to Chinese, I will continue to talk about the land premium issue because it's important. Now, the public are still very much concerned about the housing issue in Hong Kong. The cause of the housing problem here is because of inadequate supply. So we have to try to address this problem as the government. If we want to increase housing, we have to increase land supply. Part of the land supply comes from the government. The other part comes from developers or private land source. And for private land, for a good number of those plots, the lease now states that it's not for residential purpose. But in terms of planning, the land use could be converted to residential use. Let's say if it's an industrial land or agricultural land, then there's a change of land use, and then the government will have to ask people to pay a premium, and the government will take all that premium for the added value to the land. Now, on how premium is assessed in the past, the lands department and the landowners may have different views, and because agreement could not be reached, so the land is left idle, and that leads to wastage. Now, we've had communications with the sector, and we've come up with this new initiative. The applicant, that is the developer, if they could not agree with the government on the land premium, then we would use a third party to conduct arbitration, and then we could decide on a binding value for the land premium. Hopefully then, developers will pay the land premium and develop the site. So for sites that are left idle now because no agreement could be reached on the land premium, these sites could now be released for development, and it will help to boost housing production. This issue, like many other issues, we cannot just leave it to the government alone. Now this is an initiative, and we hope there will be positive response from the real estate sector, as they have said before. So hopefully together, and hopefully they will now make applications for land lease modification as soon as possible. Mr. Shek, any supplementary question? Well, Hong Kong people could buy Hong Kong land, and if there are units available, of course people can buy the units. But then property prices are so high because flour costs so much. There's raw materials cost so much. Every time the government launches sites for sale, but every time the tender price is a record high. If the flour is so expensive, of course bread will be expensive. So how do you address this issue? You have a high land price policy, although it's not spelled out, but this policy has been in existence for more than six decades. So are you going to address that? Chief Executive, the government does not have a high land price policy, because if we did, we would not have to work so hard to boost land supply in the short, medium to long and long terms. Now, many of you who are also district councillors, you would know that we've been trying to lobby district councils, and we've also asked the district or local opinion leaders to support the government's effort in changing land use. We've worked very hard on that. On a number of occasions, when there's an amendment to the outline zoning plan, district people have strong views. I actually called up the relevant district councillors myself. I tried to lobby them, explain things to them. At the end of the day, it's all about supply. If we could provide sufficient land in time, including developing greenfield sites or for brownfield sites, but not for residential use, if we could change the land use, I think that would be the root solution to the problem. Now, Mr. Shek referred to high property prices. In my policy address, so I've come up with this concept of a ladder for home ownership. So we want people to move up the ladder so their living condition will keep improving and they will have their own homes. That's why we are reviving the home ownership scheme. This year, the first batch of HOS flats will be launched in the market. I'm sure the demand will far outstrip the supply. Like the Greenwood Villa, there was oversubscription by several dozens of times. So I hope there will be sufficient land so we could keep providing HOS units for those who are eligible. If they cannot afford private housing, then they could buy HOS. Dr. Helena Wong. Well, just now, Ms. Claudia Mo asked a question. I'd like to follow up on that. Now, Chief Executive, you want to give subsidy to students to go to studies on the mainland. You say there are now more grassroots children going to the mainland to study. So you're giving them a subsidy of $15,000. Yes, good. But how come only grassroots children have to go to the mainland to study? Don't give the impression that they are keen to go there. How come for the better off families or middle class families, they're not keen to send their children to the mainland for further studies? Actually, in paragraph 96 of the policy address, you have mentioned this point. What's caused that phenomenon? Because for students who are eligible for university education, their number far outstrips the number of subsidized places provided by the government. So why don't you provide more resources so that there'll be more subsidized first-year, first-degree places? No, instead, you tell them, go to the mainland to study. I'll give you $15,000, now go away. Now, of course, we know there are some renowned universities in the mainland. For example, history subject for the Beijing University, Peking University is world-renowned, but not everybody wants to read history. Now, so you're just giving them $15,000 and send them away. Or if they don't want to go to the mainland, then they could take up sub-degree programs. But the thing is, for sub-degree programs, there are now over 40,000 people who completed their sub-degree programs. There are no conversion places for them in the senior years of university education. And so you say, okay, we are giving you another additional 1,000 senior year places. But then it's because 40,000 people couldn't further their education, so why they have to go to the mainland? So Hong Kong people are really concerned that our very cherished tertiary education resources, are they being used by Hong Kong people? Chief Executive, you explain why you're using Hong Kong's resources and you let so many mainland students to come to Hong Kong for postgraduate studies. Each place costs $500,000, but you wouldn't increase the number of first-year, first-degree places. Instead, you're giving young people $50,000 and send them off to the mainland. Is that a responsible way to spend public money?
Chief Executive, the SAIG attaches a lot of importance to education for young, especially tertiary education. As far as higher education is concerned, as far as financial resources are concerned, we have spared no efforts. One-fifth of our public money, public expenditure, is spent on education, and higher education takes up 20% or so of the educational bill. I don't think anybody can say that we don't take the matter seriously when it comes to education for the young. Dr. Helena Wong, just now my question was, are you spending public money in a responsible way? This is because public money being spent on the mainlanders who come here for graduate programs, $500,000 each. 70% of our graduate program students are mainlanders. How come that your money is not spent on local families, families who are rich, families who are poor? How come that you don't increase the number of first-year, first-degree places? You only provide 16,000 places for 25,000 who are eligible. Now, for the graduate programs, I think Dr. Helena Wong can carry out a survey concerning which programs are self-financed and which are properly financed. Dr. Wong, please stop and please take your seat. Dr. Wong, now, this is the question time, question and answer session. There shouldn't be a debate. Mr. Vincent Fang, Mr. President, Mr. Xi Yi, yesterday, right in the beginning, when you delivered your policy address, you have said that you would be developing the economy, you would be improving the livelihood. So I was glad to hear that you have done a lot to improve people's livelihood. But what about promoting economic development? I'm afraid there isn't much that you can talk about. Economic development, I think most important is to increase your revenue. Since you have got so many welfare items, if you don't increase your revenue, you cannot support them.
For the Liberal Party, yes, we have the strength in terms of ideas for economic development. Yesterday, you talked a lot. You have got many ideas. Now, for me, the ban on baby formula has given me this idea. There is the Hong Kong brand name. Now, the mainlanders have no faith in the mainland brands. So if the Hong Kong government can do more in this regard, say, for example, if we have more industrial estates, we have more science parks, then the manufacturing industries can come back to Hong Kong. And then we are producing goods that are made in Hong Kong, and they can command the confidence of the mainlanders. There are huge business opportunities, in particular, traditional Chinese medicine. They even have a strong demand for shampoos and other things. So it is a golden business opportunity. The second point is that not too long ago, the Hong Kong Monetary Authority went to the UK for investments. And yesterday, you talked about the Guangxi story. Again, it is very enlightening. I have a lot of business opportunities on the mainland. Now, we have got 11 economic and trade offices, but they haven't done much. Please ask a question. My question is, can the government set up a so-called Hong Kong business city with investment from the Hong Kong government so that you can attract thousands, tens of thousands of cases like your Guangxi story youth? So that on the one hand, we develop industrial estates so that we can produce more made in Hong Kong goods. On the other hand, in different mainland cities, we should have a number of Hong Kong business cities so that we can have investment. Mr. Fan, please give the floor to the CE. First of all, how we can make good use of the Hong Kong brand name. Second, business and professional Hong Kong citizens, how they can sort of have more opportunities on the mainland. First of all, our brand name, it isn't just confined to commodities. Mr. Vincent Fang has said that we have imported baby formula from overseas and then they are resold to mainland consumers. In addition, we have also got many products available in Hong Kong that are very popular with the mainlanders. Either they are produced by Hong Kong factories or they have been imported. We have done a lot in terms of tourism development. And then under SEPA, I'm sure Mr. Fang understands that under SEPA, in relation to certain Hong Kong-made products, the tariff has been waived. So we have got SEPA, and we're interested in how the SEPA arrangements are being implemented. A few months ago, I made the announcement that with the support of the central authorities, we have this tripartite organization that is with the input from Hong Kong, local governments of the mainland, as well as the Central People's Government, so that we can implement the SEPA arrangements properly. And then we can have our products, and then we can have them exported to the mainland, and we can ride on the advantage of the Hong Kong brand name. I think this is one of the efforts that we have put in to promote economic development. We want to make good use of SEPA. We want to ride on the opportunities of the 12-5 year plan. We are laying down the preparatory work for the 13-5 year plan. So we have been trying our best in different areas. For the brand name effect, this is not just shown in the baby formula, but also in other products. Our intellectual property rights is also one important area. In the mainland, there are inventors who have come to Hong Kong to have their intellectual property rights being registered. In fact, IPR trading is in fact one of the areas that we can seek some development. as to whether we can have a clustering effect for people of Hong Kong working or living on the mainland. Let me illustrate with an example. The Hong Kong Manufacturing Association would like to set up a center in Wuhan. I have been cooperating with the CMA and has generated results. I think the idea is quite similar to what Mr. Fang has said. What we have done was like this. We lobbied the local government, we wrote to them, etc. I agree very much that on the mainland, in fact, there are huge and better opportunities. And if we are united and for the government of Hong Kong to take proactive action, then I'm sure the effects will be even better. Mr. Fang, what about the idea of industrial estates? Are you going to have more industrial estates so that more manufacturers will come back to Hong Kong? Because the brand name of Made in Hong Kong is hugely popular. Mr. President, the utilization rate of the industrial estates is high. I got the figures just a day or two ago. For the Hong Kong Science and Technology Park Corporation, it is now having a survey concerning the utilization of the science parks. Yes, we do understand that we have shortage of land. We have to strike a balance between industrial development and economic development. We also have the housing needs. I understand the industrial estates have a lower plot ratio. Dr. Leung Kalau.
Thank you, Mr. President. In the past, the policy address would usually have some words on healthcare, though not much. If a policy is effective, it's fine, even if just have a short paragraph on it. Now, for your policy address last year and this year, you haven't come up with any effective proposals to address the most burning issue when it comes to healthcare. There is long waiting time. Now, for the emergency department, for genuinely emergency cases, generally speaking, they can be dealt with in 30 minutes' time, is fine. For those having to wait for 5 to 6 hours' time, I think most of them are non-emergency cases. Many would blame that this is due to shortage of manpower, and therefore we need to have more medical students. We may have to recruit medical doctors from overseas under restricted licensing arrangements. Now, for the hospital authorities' applications, all of them have been approved, but then they can at most fill a small number of vacancies. Now, for the doctors in the emergency department, every week they only work 44 hours. In other words, they work 4 days a week, more or less. In the private sector, we have got surplus manpower. As long as the hospital authority is willing to launch a working hours policy that pay more for working more, that is, if you pay OT and if you pay for part-time doctors, then we can easily and very quickly shorten the waiting time. I did make inquiries with the hospital authority. Dr. Leung, please don't have such a lengthy opening statement. I want to know whether the CE would support the following or direct the HA to do the following, to have a working hours policy that pay more for working more. For the work of the hospital authority, we are now having a review. Once we have the conclusions, then they will be made known to the public, including Dr. Leung Kalau. It is important to have such a review. It is the first ever review since the establishment of the hospital authority. And we want to reallocate the resources of manpower among the hospitals so that the workload of hospitals can be more evenly distributed. As to the question of the emergency departments, now you know that we have the CHIAS arrangement, and we also want to appeal to the public that they should avoid abusing the service of the emergency department. Another point is that we can make better use of the medical resources in the private sector. I think Dr. Leung is aware of this question. With both the public sector as well as the private sector, I think we want to have a balance between the two, and And of course, Chinese medicine should also be allowed to play a more important role. In my policy address, I've already talked about the development of Chinese medicine and medical drugs. We can make greater use of Chinese medicine at the front line, and we can have the collaboration between Western medicine and Chinese medicine so that the citizens of Hong Kong can get the service.
Dr. Leung, sorry, President, I'd like to follow up. A quick follow-up, please. I'm sure you, everyone has heard my question clearly. The hospital authority has said that it's up to government policy. The hospital authority has not said it would review the practice. It said it would just leave it to government policy. So can the government therefore direct the hospital authority to support a working hours policy that pays more for working more, Chief Secretary, Executive? Now we look at the role played by the hospital authority in our healthcare system and we'll consider it. Mr. Leung Yuchong, in the policy address delivered yesterday, a lot of areas are covered, but then there's just brief mentioning of a lot of the issues. For example, constitutional reform, there are just 126 characters or so. For other issues, there's not the discussion. For example, many of the labor issues involving grassroots, they're not even touched upon. On mandatory provident fund, and the offsetting arrangement with long service payment and severance pay, while this issue remains unresolved. There are still many other issues unresolved. MPF is about retirement, which is an issue mentioned by the government. But if there's but then yesterday in your policy address, you did not mention universal retirement protection either. So what do we do? You haven't addressed retirement protection. Another issue you haven't addressed is standard working hours. You said you would tackle it in your manifesto, but you haven't done anything about it. And then also for youth employment. There are 1,000 to 2,000 young people working as events coordinators. Now you have ended the contract when these contracts expire, so they can't find work. And then there are singleton grassrooters. They earn very little, but then they are left out of the low-income family working allowance. And then they are living in subdivided flats. If they want to... Now, remember, if you wish to comment on policy address, you could leave it till the debate. Please come to your question. Right, I'm talking about a whole basket of issues involving the workers. Now, during the debate, you will have plenty of time to talk about these issues. So my question for the Chief Executive, whole array of issues involving grassroots workers, how are you going to address them? President, I'm sure we all agree for this term of government, we are very much concerned about the general public, especially the employment and other issues of grassroots. In this policy address and last year's, I've said a lot on the issues. And for some of the initiatives, I would say they're groundbreaking because they were not there. That includes the low-income working family assistance. Now, we dare not say that we have now addressed all the needs of grassroots or what they expect of the government, but we'll continue to listen to views, definitely. Since we've revived the Commission on Poverty, that's an important initiative this term of the government, and then we've revived the Commission on Poverty, and we have also set an official poverty line. Now we have a better basis to go by, and then the Commission on Poverty is a good platform. Yesterday you watched Mr. Choi on TV. He said that it's a good platform and people are able to give their views and on that platform. And the chairperson of the Commission and Mrs. Carrie Lam, and I myself will certainly listen to views. So what we can do to help the grassroots workers. Now, if you have any concrete ideas, Mr. Leung will certainly consider them. And if we can do it, and if it's spending for a good cause, we'll certainly spend the money. Mr. Leung Yuchong, well, you said you listened to our views, but then over a long period in the past year or so, have you heard our views? Do I have to tell you again what I want to say? Now, what about singletons living in subsidy-divided flats? Rents are high, and then landowners keep increasing the rents. We asked for rent control. Have you heard that? If you have heard that, how come you're not implementing rent control? And then for singleton earning very low income, they're not included in this new scheme. So how are you going to address the issue? And if they want to apply for public housing, you say there will be a quota and point system, and they're only given 2,000 units when they're over 100,000 on the waiting list. So how are you going to help them? Now, we've told you all this, and you haven't listened. So you say you still want to listen to our views. What more can we say? So now I want you to tell us when you're going to address all these problems. Housing problem is, of course, long term, but how are you going to address the immediate problems? You know, helping these people get public housing, helping them with their rent problem. Chief Executive, on the housing expenses of grassroots households, yes, that's an important issue. In terms of the quality of living of low-income households, I think what affects them most must be housing, subdivided flats. Let's not even talk about caged housing. You know, they spend a good part of their income on housing, and the living condition is not in line with the high level of development in Hong Kong. On rent control, now Mr. Leung talked about many issues, but one of his specific points is about rent control. Let me respond to that. It was 30, 40 years ago that we had rent control. That was towards the end of the 1970s. The Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance, Part 2, was to impose rent control on certain buildings, and then there will be security of tenure for tenants. That is, if the tenancy expires, still the landowners could then evict the tenants. Now, that experience we had was the same as the experience overseas in relation to rent control. And then in the past 20, 30 years, property prices fluctuated. And in other cities around the world, there was also fluctuations in price movements, but governments no longer resorted to rent control to address the issue. Because if we legislate for rent control, the minute we legislate or during the course of the legislative exercise, what happened from experience is that the landowners would stop renting, or they would try to evict the tenants through all sorts of means. Why? Because once there's rent control, there will be an impact on property prices and even on the circulation of properties. So people would not be able to sell their units. And that was the experience we had in the 1970s. In those circumstances, the banks would call loans. And the bank told land property owners, well, there's going to be rent control, so we have to repay your loan. And that would affect many people. And with rent control, there would be a much smaller supply of rental properties. And of course, grassrooters couldn't afford to buy their own homes, and then rents would soar. So it would be counterproductive. So that's why we're going to try our utmost in other areas, including building more public housing units as soon as possible to meet the housing needs of the grassrooters.
Mr. Yu Siwing. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. CG, in this year's policy address in welfare, housing and education, you've come up with very concrete proposals. I'm sure the community would welcome them. As far as tourism is concerned, I'm afraid your policy address, despite having a specific paragraph or two on them, when compared with last year, we still lack concrete measures. You have the fantasy high tech and the land town development, but still like last year, they're still at the stage of carrying out a study. If we have further delays, I'm afraid this will jeopardize the tourism industry's development. I wonder if you can make a pledge that is for the two items that I've referred to. Can you not come up with a more concrete timetable and planning? Well, under the Economic Development Commission, we have got a working group on tourism, and he has come up with very good ideas, and he has assessed the picture and have made recommendations to the government. Well, all in all, as far as the tourism industry is concerned, we've got lots of potential for development. In other words, the business will just go on, and there will be more business. What we shouldn't overlook is that we need to come up with continuous publicity and promotion. The biggest problem before us is how we are going to expand our receiving capacity. We have the medium problem of the airport runway, and then scenic attractions, and then also the problem of our shopping facilities for visitors coming to Hong Kong. We can't sort of create them overnight. Therefore, in our policy address, we have proposed the development of Lantau. Now, for the artificial island of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, well, previously, the former term government did not propose anything like retail or dining. I think at most they were proposing convenience stores. Now we want to add to that, and we are talking about millions of square foot of facilities. I think if we want to raise our receiving capacity and if we are able to expand it, then we can receive more visitors. We attach a lot of importance to the development of tourism. As far as this contribution to GDP is concerned, the per capita, when compared with financial services, is lower. It is lower, but then it provides a lot of job opportunities for our grassroots citizens. And as a result, they have seen an increase in their income levels, and it is something good. Therefore, if you have got further proposals, we are most happy to listen to you and other participants in the tourism industry. Mr. Yu Siwing, I really hope that the SARG would come up with something more detailed, say, for example, the Lantau development. In this way, we can channel some visitors to Lantau rather than having them all crowded into the traditional tourism areas. You've also talked about the reaching of the capacity in a few years' time in relation to the Hong Kong airport. So we badly need the third runway. Please be concise. Even if there isn't any delay, it will be 2023 that we can have the third runway. Before we have the third runway, and if we have already reached the capacity, then can we solve the problem at all? We understand clearly the economic value of the airport. We are fully behind the airport authority's proposal to build the third runway. And the Hong Kong AA and government departments and I have many meetings to discuss the matter. Well, in fact, it is a project that has been decided on. For the days to come, we may have unforeseeable problems, say for example objection by the green groups. We'll go all out to handle the problems. Currently we are still trying to do a proper job about the design and planning of the new runway. Ms. Chen Yunhan. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Xi Yi, you have resolved the problem of working poverty. It is something that we have been drawing your attention to for many years. Of course, I'm referring to the low-income working family allowance. Of course, the workers will ask me this question. What about the offsetting of the MPF contribution? What about long working hours? What about retirement protection? They have got a host of questions. They just wonder whether the CE has forgotten the 3 million workers in the labor force. Now, the business sector is challenging us. Now, of course, I'm grateful to Mr. Tian. Now, many workers now understand that by having the offsetting arrangement, a lot will be lost. I think many people have expected a lot from you. Now, they are wondering whether I haven't been hardworking enough. I've promised them to be more hardworking. So I put a question to you. Have you forgotten the 3 million workers in the labor force because you want to accommodate the business sector? What about the offsetting arrangements? Mr. President, when I drafted the policy address, my government colleagues have talked to the labor sector. In relation to the offsetting arrangements, we have more meetings with the labor sector than with the business sector. So this is the first question's answer. We will take a comprehensive review and will continue with the work. We hope that both Ms. Chen and other friends from the labor sector will continue to have liaison with the Hong Kong government. How much more time do you have? Just slightly more than 3 years. Let me finish with my question. Within your term, now you need to carry out amendments to 2 major pieces of legislation. That's, of course, about offsetting. And then do you really think that you have sufficient time? The 2 sectors are in a polarized situation where the labor sector and they are the business sector. You mustn't delay. You haven't got much time, just 3 years or so within your current term, not to mention our time. We have got even less time than that for our term. So you have to resolve the problems. First, offsetting. Second, standard working hours, which you have promised the trade unions. And then another one is retirement protection. Can you promise to deliver on the 3 issues within your term?
Well, these issues have been around for a long time and they have not been addressed. There must be a reason to that because these are rather complex issues. The SAL government is willing to explore these issues together with you. Of course, we want to achieve what we want to achieve quickly, but at the same time, we want to make sure we do a proper job. When we worked on statutory minimum wage, there was this episode. Now, I've all along supported our statutory minimum wage, but when it came to the legislative exercise, it was something that we found out we didn't think about, and that caused a bit of delay, and that's about the meal hour wage. So that's why when we consider such policies or if we need to amend legislation, we have to consider the whole issue thoroughly so that we don't have to patch up later. Madam Chen, you've used up your time. Madam Chen, please take your seat. Dr. Kenneth Chen. Hong Kong people want housing, but Hong Kong people also want true universal suffrage. I don't know if Mr. Cheung Chee Kong is upstairs. He compared the relationship between the Pan Democrats and the mainland to that between the mainland and Japan. I think that's ridiculous. Where did you find people like that? So we, the middle class, are not helped at all in this policy address, but we, the middle class, pay tax to you to hire people like that that would only do a disservice to the government. Now, Chief Executive, you want a name to be written into the history book. Would you like to be like the Romanian dictator who was overthrown by the people, or you want to be like Gorbachev who listened to the people's views and promoted universal suffrage? I find these analogies also pointless. They don't make sense. You know, Romania, the former Soviet Union, the situation there was entirely different than that in Hong Kong. Now, I've said this many times, I and the government and colleagues in charge of this issue will certainly comply strictly with the basic law and the interpretations and decisions of the MPC Standing Committee in promoting, in taking forward universal suffrage for the C election. Now, I have to order Mr. Albert Chen and Mr. Ray Chen to leave the chamber at once. The 2 members, leave at once. Do not hold up the proceedings.
立即离开会议.
Leave at once. Leave the chamber at once. Dr. Kenneth Chen, the CE and I do not have the crystal ball. We don't know what will happen to you yet, but I can tell you this. If you think the nominating committee cannot be a rubber stamp, can you tell us here and now that for Hong Kong people's one person, one vote, it must not be a rubber stamp? Is that we should have a true universal suffrage for CE without selection? President, while we have to premise a proposal, any proposal on the basic law and the interpretations and the decisions of the MPC Standing Committee, we will certainly comply with the basic law provisions and these interpretations and decisions in doing a proper job with universal suffrage for the election in 2017. Mr. Ben Chen, now you want to bring in limited practice by overseas doctors and in addressing the shortage of healthcare personnel, but I don't think this will address the immediate issues. Tuen Mun Hospital, there was a report to say that the quality of service wasn't desirable. It's because in Tuen Mun Hospital, they've always had high demand, but they don't have enough staff. And Port Oi Hospital could not help to channel off some of the patients. Now, for a long time, Tuen Mun Hospital's problems are not recognized, and now people blame Tuen Mun Hospitals for poor service quality, so staff morale is very much affected, and that won't be good for the public. So in the face of the Tuen Mun Hospital issue, what are you going to do? Are you going to give more resources to individual hospitals, or perhaps during the Chinese New Year, go to visit the healthcare personnel in Tuen Mun Hospital, bring along a fruit basket and so on, so you could rally them on and listen to their views. Now, during the election and after I was elected, I always attached great importance to healthcare personnel issue. During the election, I met with many different groups and listened to the views, and then I drafted my manifesto. The healthcare sector was one that I have met most for the longest time. You know, on the breaks for doctors, the meal arrangements, so on. I've talked to them until midnight. Yes, we do have some tough issues, and it's true that some of the issues may not be addressed immediately, but since I took office for the past year or so, I've been working hard to at least offer some relief and also for a long-term solution. Like last year, we gave $13 billion to hospitals to carry out minor improvement works so they could improve their environment, the working environment, and providing service. And in this policy address, I talk about building new hospitals, expanding old hospitals, or redeveloping existing hospitals. And then in Kai Tak, we will have acute general hospital. So we have come up with all these policy initiatives. As for traditional Chinese medicine, we said that it could complement other medical services. As for how we make arrangements for different hospitals, I think on the whole, we need to increase our service capacity before we could address the issues you mentioned, and we'll certainly press on with our work. Mr. Ben Chen, Chief Executive, would you go to the Tuen Mun Hospital during Chinese New Year and rally the staff on there? You know, if their staff morale is poor, it will hurt the public. Especially under the hospital cluster system, they get few resources and staff morale is poor. So imagine the lives of new territories where residents are in their hands. Maybe it doesn't sound right, so would you consider my suggestion, please? Chief Executive, through various means, we will certainly rally on our colleagues in the public health sector. Thank you for your suggestion. But about 2 weeks ago, on New Year's Eve night, together with Dr. Ko Wing Man, we went to free annual dinners of the healthcare sector, and we met many healthcare personnel on those occasions, including the Tsuen Wen Hospital staff you mentioned. And on that occasion, we were able to listen to views and also give them some encouragement. Now, as to what more we could do in this respect, please, Mr. Chen, give us your ideas. Mr. Portier, on helping the poor, you have quite a number of new policy initiatives. You also make adjustments to some existing initiatives. Perhaps as you consider these initiatives, you did have a chance to refer to the Kong Yuanming Court of Final Appeal case. Because because of that ruling, then we could only increase welfare, we could not cut welfare. Now, I'm a representative of the middle class, where maybe I also have a coffee and watch French films. Maybe I don't. But anyway, I think as the middle class, I'm really disappointed. You know, in Hong Kong, if you ride on the MTR, you see young people and middle-aged people always reading their mobile phones. Now, we should be like Singapore or South Korea. We don't just want policies for helping the poor or adjustment to policies on helping the poor, because if that's the case, Frederick Fung would be a better CE. We should be talking about economic development. We keep talking about the Economic Development Commission, the Financial Services Development Council. They keep looking into issues. They don't have any concrete policies. I think that's disappointing. And anyway, in terms of tax relief, there's nothing for the middle class. So we just take this opportunity and the budget that's about to be presented, would you do more for the middle class in terms of tax relief or perhaps MPF weight exemption and so on? Could you do something to help them? Now, for this policy address, there were breakthroughs in terms of helping the poor, the old, and the infirm, or the disadvantaged. But at the same time, we have not overlooked the importance of economic development and the needs of other sectors in the community. That's why in the policy address I said this. We must attach equal importance to both the economy and people's livelihood. I've been saying this in the past few years, that we have to ensure proper economic development in Hong Kong so that the government would have the resources to address long-standing problems in Hong Kong, four problems that including people's livelihood. In fact, in the policy address, we have said a lot about economic development. There are 11 industries, not just the financial services sector. There are 11 sectors, creative, the IP sector, the creative industry sector, shipping, the high value-added shipping industry. These are all emerging industries. We have the advantage. We could do well in these sectors. And there are two new platforms, Pearl River Delta Collaboration, and the other is the Lantau Island. Now, we face different sectors in the community. I believe the government should play different roles. For the grassroots sector, they face some basic issues about subsistence. So that's why we need to give them subsidies so they could lead a relatively stable life. For middle class, what do they care most about? For example, housing, the housing ladder, stable property prices, education of the children, the quality of living, including the quality of the environment. So it's a different approach than in supporting grassrooters. For example, it's not through cash subsidy that we could support them. Rather, we should spend our money on boosting our competitiveness so there will be economic development, and we should spend on the quality of living. That's why in the policy address, which is all-round the policy address, we do have initiatives in these areas. Many here are professionals. Perhaps I can tell you what the SA our government does to promote the development of different industries in our economic structure. As you know, more than a decade ago, I proposed, I advocated the setting up of a professional group. There are some 10 professional bodies being members. And then we had SEPA. In SEPA, every year there will be provisions on professional services. If we don't, these measures not implemented properly, then I keep fighting for it. And then when I was elected, I had the support of the Central People's Government. We are able to set up a tripartite working group to deal with issues in relation to CEPA today. For professional services, 2011, GDP is $88 billion. It's not a small sum. It's not a large sum, but tourism, $86.2 billion, professional service, $86 billion. And in the annual increase per year is 11.3% in terms of the growth in GDP, but in terms of the number of professionals, it's just 3.3%. That means you can see the per capita GDP share has gone up a lot for the professional services. Now, we're not Singapore. We're not the mainland. In Hong Kong, we have our own characteristics. We have our own systems. So for either traditional industries or emerging industries, we'll bear in mind Hong Kong's characteristics and we'll leverage on our advantage. And the government will actively promote developments of different industries. I believe by doing so, we could help the middle class to have better job opportunities, more stable income, and better career prospects.
Mr. Paul Chair, I'm not against poverty alleviation. Yes, there is a need for it. Now, Mr. CE, you know that the middle class will be the class that break or make a society. Now, maybe you just go after the applause from the grassroots. Don't do it at the expense of the middle class interest. Now, you have said that there's only the Hong Kong camp. There won't be any more a Tang camp or the Leung camp. Now, please don't ignore the interest of the middle class. It is important for Hong Kong. So would you once again consider tax concessions? Do something more concrete for the middle class. Don't just talk about consultations, studies, etc. Come up with something more concrete for the middle class, please. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Paul Chair, for your advice. The Hong Kong SALG does understand the importance of the middle class, say, for example, the role that they play in Hong Kong. Just now, I've said that for the middle class, we help them in a way different from the help we tendered to the grassroots. We will equally be aware of the needs of the middle class. And Mr. Paul Chair can certainly tell us about any ideas he has for helping the middle class. The Chief, this is the end of the question and answer session. The Chief Executive will now leave the chamber. Members will please stand up. I now adjourn the council until 11 a.m. on Wednesday, 22nd of January 2014.